Hello, my name's Julie Sturgis and I'm the CEO of Healthy North Coast. And we deliver the Primary Health Network program for the Commonwealth on the north coast of New South Wales. I'd like to also acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land that we're on today. For me, that's the Bundjalung people, and pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. Today, we're quickly talking about some work that we've been doing about using decision support technology to make sure that we're investing in sustainable ways to create outcomes for the communities of the North Coast. So this work was first undertaken because looking at the burning deck of a platform of needing to provide a very large growth in mental health services without the necessary consequent funding to be able to do that. So one of the first things we did as an organisation was look at whether we were optimising the way we were currently spending money. And certainly what we saw in relation to the burden of the North Coast is that, we were potentially only delivering services to about 5% of that group. So there was a really clear need for us to look at how we would do that more efficiently and provide better outcomes. So certainly we looked at both the efficiency and the outcomes from the money we did spend, but also we did take a bit of a portfolio approach where we looked at the risk associated with unfunded projects as well. Because really, decision making around where to best invest money needs to look at the entire portfolio and the risk associated with it. The work that we did, first of all, was really to try and understand and calculate the burden of disease, but or for mental health anyway, on the North Coast. And then to examine the value of all the programs. And the way we identified value was, essentially the amount of burden that the particular intervention alleviated as a result of the program. And I think critically, the most important thing we found was that without even looking at new services, but investing at different levels in the services we already did have, we could create much better outcomes for the North Coast community when we truly understood the benefit versus the investment. So, when we were looking at optimizing investment, we realized that we couldn't only look at our own investment. And so, we were lucky enough to work closely with the LHDs and certainly MBS funding as well to really understand perhaps, other contributors to the overall system of providing care. And what we found when we looked at that is a real ability to look very closely, by LGA and by age group around just how we were meeting the demand for services with all of our respective investment. And I think it's fair to say that, it was quite illuminating for us as commissioners and providers of service to realize that, in some places we were continuing to throw money where potentially there was much less unmet need. So it really gave us some very clear ideas about where we collectively needed to be putting that investment and, instigated some discussion around strategies we could work on together to make sure that we met that need rather than just our own small pot of funding. And, particularly as a region, and when you're looking at regional commissioning, making sure that we are creating the ability for to equitably deliver outcomes for communities most at need. So understanding the benefit of what you are investing in is a key part of it. But there is another piece to this, and that is what does the future look like and how do we drive better investment related to outcomes? And to do that, we developed what we're calling a complex and dynamic systems model, really to understand the complexity of delivering healthcare and what's involved in there. This was co-designed with the community of the North Coast, and so we feel very confident that it is reflecting the way the service system works for them. And I guess critically, with this complex and dynamic system, there are many, many factors. And certainly, for each one of the elements of this model, we have used an evidence-based approach and any published evidence to actually validate the accuracy of that. Do we think we've got it right? Certainly we do. We believe through a validation process that we can accurately rely on the forward projections of this modelling. And the reason we think that is that we actually, instead of projecting forward, we also use the last 7 years of data to retrospectively project. And what we found is that the outputs of the model very closely matched the actual data sets. This is an example, psychiatric hospitalizations. The model is the red line and the blue is the actuals. And similarly, if I go to some other areas like ED presentations, the model matches very closely. How does this help us project forward? Look, the reality is that if we project, and this dashboard here projects the status quo, and what that says is if services continue to grow in line with population growth at the same levels, these are the outcomes we would expect to see. We can look at all sorts of parameters in this, but for this one, we're going to use suicides per year. So I think critically though, working with community and with clinicians, it gives us the opportunity to run some scenarios around what does the future look like and how can we invest better. I could go on forever, but I'll run just a couple for you. Lots of clinicians said we need a lot more GP services, a lot more psychiatry and allied health, and of course, let's not forget acute hospital beds as the cure for all things. And so, you know, I think it was really interesting and very interesting working with community, because we did see that those interventions had a short-term impact. But over the long term, in fact, they didn't deliver the quantum of change that we were actually looking for with suicide prevention. And indeed, all mental health presentations. So I think, you know, one of the things we learned from this is that sometimes we just think that adding more means you will get more in terms of outcomes. But the reality in this modeling is that we didn't see that at all. And in fact, adding more at very high cost did not deliver great changes in outcomes into the future. There are a couple of things that were standouts as far as delivering outcomes. And I'll give you a quick look at those now, but particularly they were low cost interventions, really. Social connectedness, technology enabled coordinated care and post attempt care. And in comparison to the very expensive additions of acute beds and a lot of extra service professionals, we found that those interventions actually for the North Coast community delivered a much larger quantum in outcomes for both mental health outcomes and suicide prevention, and certainly in a shorter time frame as well. So I guess what it led us to do as a community is have some really transparent discussions about who does make the decisions about health investment and the outcomes that we're seeking. So what does all this mean when we're structuring our portfolio of investment for outcomes? I think we learned some critical lessons, and we don't certainly have all the answers yet, but it did give us an opportunity to have some very frank discussions across all services. If we're investing for outcomes, the opportunities for benefits gained, and you know, the awful discussion that, you know, no one likes to have about potentially disinvesting in services which are of low value. Certainly you can see from just this, you know, brief scenario, what we've done here is compare investing in some of those immediate things that the modeling showed us would deliver benefit, and disinvesting in some things, well, not necessarily disinvesting, perhaps reducing the growth of some services we traditionally continue to grow, mostly because they're very easy to count. And so if I look at this scenario, you know, red sort of means you're not getting a lot of value with a particular service, and green means actually there are a lot of outcomes to be gained. And certainly we know with disinvestment, sometimes there are some negative outcomes. You can see there in the bottom line that in actual fact, we said if we reduce the growth in psychiatry and allied health services by 10% to invest in other services, mostly social connectedness in this scenario, would there be some negative outcomes? And you can see that in actual fact, there was probably one more suicide death and potentially about 5,000 more GP visits as a result of that. So again, we have to accept the risk associated with what we're not investing in. But critically, when you look at the investment then in social connectedness, we saw that the qualies potentially gained were about 40,000 qualies. And in fact, the suicide deaths reduced by doing that were about 60. And we actually had about 270,000 less GP visits. So in fact, until you start looking across a portfolio at what you are investing in and what you're not investing in, it's very hard to make well-informed decisions for the future of healthcare. So to conclude, there is definitely process work that needs to be done to get to the point where our health portfolio is delivering the best outcomes for our community. It is not without a considerable amount of work, but the approach we've taken on the North Coast is that it is work worth doing. And certainly when we look to a future of regional commissioning where we truly take a portfolio approach to investment to maximise the outcomes for our community, they're necessary steps to walk through. So the learnings from this, it takes time to collect data and share data. It definitely takes time to have clear discussions around investing for outcomes, and certainly the governance surrounding it and achieving something that works for everyone is no mean feat. But I will just finish once again our adage, and that is, it's a problem worth solving. So good luck, everybody.